Well, good afternoon, everyone. As Dennis said, my name is Jaideep Raje. I'm a senior consultant with Lux. I'm going to debate calling this spot a cherished spot. I mean, when I was told that this was going to be my spot to speak, I really saw this very much as a bad news, good news thing. I mean, I am really standing between 300 people and their alcohol. There's no way I'm going to win with this. But I'm going to try and sort of work around that by trying to tell you some stories, you know, stories about great companies and the way they innovate. But there's also a good news to the slot here, which is I see this very much as the connective tissue, if you will, between day one and day two. You know, today you've heard a lot of companies and great speakers talk about how they're doing technology scouting, how they're trying to do innovation and new business development for their core business, for the near term. Tomorrow is all about looking a little beyond and seeing how you can do it for the future. And one of the elements that sort of goes into that is a way of looking at convergent innovation, right? So where you might be taking things that are a part of your core business and trying to deploy them in adjacent markets, in areas that were heretofore untapped. In doing that, you might also identify some altogether new business models, altogether new types of partners and markets, which could sort of drive your new business in the future. And what drives that convergent innovation is partnerships. Now, all of us get this, right? We are all here. We all believe in ecosystem thinking and putting these partner networks together. But if you look at examples of companies that have tried to do this, you'll realize that this ecosystem thinking alone is not enough. In fact, if that is all you did, if all you did was realize, hey, I need an ecosystem, your chances of failure would be pretty likely, actually. When you start thinking about innovations as something that require an ecosystem, there is an implication to that way of thinking, and which is what we'll talk about a fair bit today. And then we'll go on from that and look at what do those implications require us to do, and what sort of roles do we need to take on. And then finally, we'll try and apply this framework, you know, as Dennis mentioned, to certain areas which might benefit from this way of thinking. To start off, I'll take you back to the year 1999 and the world of mobile telephony. Right, so this was 2G was the king. Everybody realized that, especially in the developed world, the market was getting saturated. So for the telecom companies and the handset developers to get increasing product and market share, they needed to look for the next best thing. And that next thing was going to be 3G, the ability to watch streaming video on your phone, you know, do all the kinds of things that we do today. And the leader in the space was Nokia. So you might remember these funky phones where you could take the tops off and put differently colored ones on. But this was a problem that others in the space were also looking at. So you'll see that all of these companies were focused on developing a 3G smartphone in that period. Everybody believed that the determining factor for success here was going to be the classic first mover advantage. The guys who came up with a nice device first to the market were the ones who were going to capture it. And Nokia really challenged itself and its suppliers to make that happen. So in the year 1999, Nokia actually released the 6650, which some observers actually called the most complex consumer electronics device ever designed. And to make that happen, Nokia and its partners or suppliers had to come up with some fairly heroic innovations. You know, across the board, there's some militant vigor here in trying to come up with radical new algorithms, new displays, things of that nature. And Nokia was first to the European market. They beat Ericsson by a fair margin. And you know, as you would expect such a company to do, they were projecting some pretty dramatic success. In fact, what actually happened was by two orders of magnitude, they missed the market estimate. But in fact, the vast majority of the market was actually in Japan on the closed NTT network, which was only accessed by the Docomo phones. So not only were they off in terms of the market projection, a vast majority of that market was actually taken up by a completely different competitor. So where did Nokia miss the boat so badly? Well, let's take one of the components of a 3G phone, which is, you know, the streaming video feature, if you will, and let's look at what is required to enable that. Well, you need the phone, which, you know, Nokia and its suppliers successfully developed. But you also need video conversion software. You need database and router innovations. And you need DRM rights to assure the content providers that their precious content is not going to be pirated. Nokia wasn't going to develop all of these things. So you now had essentially a Ferrari on cobbled street roads. There was nothing for the Nokia smartphone to be doing. And that's really where Nokia messed up. They had an excellent product, but they simply lacked the vision to think about this as a problem that required an ecosystem thinking. This particular case is actually reviewed in great detail by Professor Ron Adner in his book, The Wide Lens, and I'd greatly recommend that to all of you. But now if you look at these two components, the product and the ecosystem vision, would that guarantee a successful innovation? Well, not, if you ask Michelin. In the 1990s, Michelin was the clear market leader, right? They had about 20% of the tire market and were believed to be well ahead of their nearest competitor when it came to simply being the most innovative company around. Back then, they released their pack system, which was a run-flat tire. So I don't know if you're familiar with this, but this allowed a driver, after they had a puncture, to keep driving for about 125 miles and drive that distance at about 55 miles per hour. So essentially, you were no longer going to be stranded by the roadside. It could potentially avoid a lot of accidents, and it would let you get to the nearest repair shop and get your tire fixed. Now, Michelin was obviously very excited about this, and you know, they called this their most significant innovation in a long time, but also industry observers like the Motor Trend magazine actually called this the most important component in a car. Michelin understood that for this innovation to actually penetrate the market, they needed to build out an ecosystem. So they started doing just that. One of the first and most interesting things they did was actually strike an alliance with their leading competitor, the number two tire maker in the world, Goodyear. But after that, they also started building out a bigger coalition that involved the number four and the number nine tire makers in the world, essentially capturing well over 50% of the potential market share. Right? So PAX at that point was almost the industry standard. But what Michelin also understood was that for such an innovation, which, you know, the PAX system required integration very much at the OEM stage, they had to bring on some OEM partners. So what they did was actually sign on a whole slew of marquee auto OEMs to be lead adopters of the PAX system. So, you know, there's a clear consumer need here that they've identified. They've brought on a partner ecosystem, both in terms of other tire makers and auto OEMs. And they expected a pretty dramatic success. They expected that within a 10-year period, the PAX system would be the only tire on the roads. What actually happened is pretty interesting. In the U.S. market, Michelin and its auto OEM partners were actually the subject of a class action lawsuit, and I'll go into why in just a minute. But in addition to that, in the year 2007, Michelin stopped all development on the PAX system, citing insufficient market demand. So what causes an innovation that is so dramatic and radical to fail so miserably? Well, let's look at the ecosystem that Michelin needed to build out for something like this to enter the market. You know, you obviously needed the PAX system. You had to work with the two lead partners that they brought into the ecosystem. But then you needed to bring in some other players. You needed car dealers, tire dealers to have access to both the new car as well as the aftermarket sales market. But then you also needed service and repair shops. And that's where Michelin really, really messed up. For the PAX system to enter the market, what was needed was a service and repair infrastructure that would have to buy expensive new equipment, a new way to clamp and unclamp the tire. You needed new equipment to measure the tire pressure and monitor it. And finally, you needed to certify your staff. All of these were fairly expensive endeavors that required an altogether new role for the service and repair shops, a role that they were unwilling to adopt. Where Michelin failed was they had an excellent product, they had an ecosystem vision, but they did not execute on that vision just right. Now you see where this is going. Again, if you look at the way this is building out, you know that there's one more component that's missing. And that component comes to us from a North American example, the experience of GM and the fuel cell vehicle. Now, I hate to pick on GM here because, you know, all of us know every single auto OEM has struggled miserably with the fuel cell vehicle. But let's, for illustration purposes, let's start with GM, right? So some of you might remember a few years ago, GM had these Equinoxes that were running around. These were demo vehicles. 100 of these were out there, fuel cell cars. But what they also did, very interestingly, was started to build a pretty complex and complete ecosystem. They participated in a couple of partnerships and coalitions that gave them access to other automakers, energy companies, fuel cell companies, and government agencies, the folks who were both setting the policy as well as the ones who were maybe doing the research, like NREL. In addition to that, they partnered with folks who were developing component and business model innovations, so both in terms of startups, small mid-sized companies, university labs, as well as fleet owners, you know, FedEx, USPS. By doing that, what GM expected was a full commercialization of the fuel cell vehicle for the general public by the year 2010. And GM was not alone in that estimate, right? If you look at the list of companies up there, that's pretty much a global who's who of the automotive space. Every single car company developing fuel cells in the 1990s told you by 2010 that was going to be widely available to the general public. GM actually predicted you know, six-figure sales by the year 2010, later revised it down to five figures. Now, I'll show you some data from our mobile energy team. This is our estimate of the fuel cell vehicle market over the next 20 years almost. If you look at the way the chart is going, only in the most optimistic oil price scenario do you end up at a six-figure market size. In every other scenario, you're well below that number, and there is no way you're even hitting significant five-figure sales in the next decade. If you compare that with the estimates of some of the smartest auto brains in the world, you only begin to wonder, why did they fail so miserably? Well, they failed miserably because they did not understand the joint probability implication of such an ecosystem. You know, if you look at an innovation ecosystem that involves you and a few other partners, you're really only as strong as your weakest link. If you have a partner, let's say in this case a fuel cell vehicle technology developer, that has a much lower probability of success because they're working on an especially challenging innovation, your entire ecosystem is really at the mercy of that particular innovation succeeding. Well, let's say you have access to a bunch of cash. Yeah? Let's say you have €1 million to spend to try and improve the overall probability of success. One of the things you could do is try and dump it into your own R&D organization to improve your product. Right? This is the default path that most of our companies would take. But an alternate pathway that you could choose is to take that money and invest it in an altogether different partner, the weakest link in the ecosystem, and help them improve their particular problem innovation. Now, I would love to be a fly on the wall when that discussion happens in a company, right? When somebody in your R&D organization says, hey, we have this cash, let's go and invest it in an altogether different company. That's pretty unlikely to happen, even though most people understand that the probability of the overall success of the ecosystem is actually much greater in path two than in path one. Sometimes in an innovation ecosystem, you need to divert resources away from your own products to a partner's products in order to improve the overall chances of success. And that's where not only GM, but a lot of its peers have been failing over the last few years. And they continue to do that even today. So, you know, in the case of the GM example, you'll see that it was this understanding of the probability of the ecosystem, that's where they struggled. And that brings us to sort of this complete view of what's required for an innovation ecosystem to succeed. The implication of an ecosystem think is that you need these four components to be in concert. But what you also have to understand that when you look at this flow, sometimes you might need to go back and revisit the innovation that you yourself are working on. You might need to take out certain features. You might need to deprioritize certain partners just in order to get that minimally viable product out into the market. But there's a bigger picture to this as well. The bigger picture is these four components do not just come together on their own. You have to bring them together. There is a person in the ecosystem that brings them together, and that is that critical element of the partnership ecosystem. Now, we are going to call this the alpha partner, right? The key idea that I want to leave with you today is that convergent innovation, one that pulls in widgets from a variety of different players, requires an ecosystem think that is driven by an alpha partner. Now, when you hear the word alpha, you're probably thinking of this fella, right? You're thinking of that silverback gorilla that's in a band of gorillas somewhere out there in the wild that's doing this chest thumping and getting everybody to fall in line. But the picture is a little bit nuanced than that. If you look at the ethnological origin of the term alpha, it applies both to males and females, and these are really the individuals in the community with the highest rank. The way they acquire that rank is sometimes on the basis of physical prowess, but quite often it is because of their social efforts. It's because of their ability to build alliances within that community that makes them the alpha. So if you try and sort of work this out, you know, to the alpha male or female in the wild compared to the alpha partner in the innovation ecosystem, there are certain commonalities and certain implications of that. You know, firstly, the alpha partner in an innovation ecosystem is one that drives the vision, one that coordinates and makes some of the hard choices. It's the one that may or may not have the greatest share of the cost stack. Think about that for a second. We're saying that the alpha partner, the one who's going to drive an innovation ecosystem, might be one that has a much smaller share of the cost stack than some of the other players. And I'll go into that in a bit. Understand that the alpha partner may or may not be the largest player in the ecosystem, but it is certainly the most connected one. The alpha partner in an innovation ecosystem is one that gains its rank from its ability to make those connections that are required. And finally, this rank that an alpha partner acquires and who becomes the alpha is actually very, very market dependent. So you might be looking at the same sort of end market, but the type of company that takes on the alpha role might be very different in the North American market than one in the Asian market or the European market. So let's dig into that in some detail, and let's start with a really easy example, right? Let's look at Amazon and its Kindle family of products. Now, the Kindle was released back in 2007, a year after the Sony e-reader. A lot of you might remember this from back then, but every analyst out there considered the Sony e-reader not only to be a more aesthetically pleasing product, but actually one that was technologically more superior than the Amazon Kindle as well. Yet, not only did the first generation of Amazon Kindle succeed pretty dramatically, you've seen how the company has grown year over year. In Amazon's drive to capture an increasing share of the digital content consumption market, they started off and built out an entire family of products. Great innovations, right? You had the almost real looking paper view. Then you went on to a colored screen, a touch screen, one that could stream video and had an HD display, all the rest. But understand that in addition to building these products, they built out an ecosystem of content providers, folks that brought in the video games, the books, the journals and the magazines and all the rest. In addition to that, they built out an ecosystem that involved the consumers and lead adopters. These were the folks who not only purchased products from Amazon, but made recommendations for the other people so that they could find the products they needed. What Amazon also did was innovated or acquired a capability to do e-commerce. Right, make those payments, do those in a secure fashion, etc. Where Amazon acted like an alpha allowed them to gain a pretty dramatic success year over year. Now, we don't need to go into the details of any of these charts except to understand that as you go from left to right, things are going from small to high. Right? So year over year, not only have the Kindle sales been increasing, but also on the other side, the amount of content that's available in the Kindle e-store, if you will, has been going up pretty dramatically. If you compare Amazon's performance to that of the EPUB format, which is the leading format available on the Sony reader, you'll see that the Kindle format has actually been doing much, much better than its lead competitor. The reason Amazon succeeds here is because it understands, as an alpha, that they need to put that innovation ecosystem together. But now you look at this, you look back to my description of what an alpha should be, and you say, Amazon's the 800-pound gorilla in the space. You know, what are you talking about? Doesn't need to have the largest share of the cost tag, doesn't need to be the largest player. Well, let me give you an example of a different company doing just that. Let's look at Grundfos and its Lifelink system, specifically developed and and deployed in the bottom of the pyramid market. So what this is for regions that are water stressed, right? So where a wide majority of the population does not have access to clean water, Grundfos has come up with this way of accessing groundwater through borewells that allows people to get just the amount of water they need and then pay for it on spot, right? That's the whole sum total of the innovation. And the way they do that is through this LifeLink initiative. Now let's see what is Grundfos' role in this entire spread. All Grundfos does in terms of the products it brings is a submersible pump. That's all it does. It brings in its XQ Flex submersible pump. Now, to put the system together, you need a solar panel that powers this pump. You need an IT company to provide the innovation that's required for a communication and surveillance module that allows you to remotely control and monitor the space. Grundfos understood this. That's what they brought to the picture. But then, as they tried to take this to the developing world markets, you know, to Kenya in particular, they realized they did not have access to the market. They did not have any local networks. They did not have an ability to find the consumers and interact with them and market the system to them and all the rest. And that's where they understood that they needed to start building an ecosystem. So Grundfos goes out there, establishes partnerships with local NGOs and service companies, so that, you know, they could use those as the marketing channels and then provide after-sales service. They work with a local construction company that is able to now build these systems to the specs that the local community needs. They start working with a Kenyan bank that allows them to provide the easy financing that would be required for to set these systems up at a community level. But then they realize that a big problem in that market is not simply getting access to water. It's also your ability to pay for it in a fair and fast fashion. So now what Grundfos has to do is go out there and establish partnerships with Safaricom, the Vodafone's subsidiary there, and with M-Pesa. What these two players allow Grundfos to do is link the consumer's bank accounts with their mobile phones using a key fob and an RFID-based system that the consumer can then use to pay for the water at the point of consumption. If you look at this picture that is now emerged in front of you, what you will see is that Grundfos' share of this cost tag is pretty small. The largest share of the value is actually captured by the guys here on the mobile payment side. Yet, Grundfos is the one that has driven and brought this entire ecosystem together. In doing that, they've been able to not only deploy a pretty sizable number of their pumps into this market and build a local network, but they've also been able to speak to their corporate goal, which was to try and provide water to these water-stressed parts of the world. They're now rolling the system out in Asia and other parts of Africa. The reason Grundfos succeeds here is because they act like an alpha and complete that entire ecosystem. Now let's look at an altogether different industry and example. Let's look at Coca-Cola and what it has been doing with the plant bottle initiative. Now, I'm sure a lot of you have seen this on the shelf at the supermarkets and the stores. You know, Coca-Cola came out with this bottle that had up to 30% bio-based content. Heinz then established a partnership with Coca-Cola and got access to their plant bottle technology. What Coca-Cola has done with this approach is shown a pretty unique understanding of the joint probability implication that we talked about. Their Gen 1 product only has up to 30% bio-based content. And the reason for that is the only content that they can guarantee at this stage is the monoethylene glycol part of the equation. The purified terephthalic acid is a pretty hard nut to crack, and so they've stayed away from that for their Gen 1 product. In Gen 2, they're actually going to go to 100% bio-based or recycled content. It's only at a much later stage that they want to tackle and promise a 100% bio-based bottle. Now, if you look at this picture, what you will see is Coca-Cola is only really interested in the final outcome, which is to improve the bio-based share of their bottles. They don't particularly care which technology brings this to the market, right? So what they've started to do is they picked three different players to work on the bio-based PET aspect. They picked Givo, Berent, and Avantium, all companies that our bio-based materials and chemicals teams cover. And if you look at these three players, they have very different routes to go from sugars to the end game, which is PET. Right? So Gevo has a yeast fermentation-based route that takes them to isobutanol and then paraxylene. Because it's yeast-based, much slower process, order of days, not hours. Because it's yeast-based, the isobutanol actually tends to poison the yeast, so you need to continuously withdraw it. So there are process complexities associated with it. So even though the Gevo process is probably the more mature of the three, it has some of its complications that need to be figured out. That's where somebody like a Virent comes in, for example. Uses a two-step catalytic conversion, a much faster process, gets you to, you know, a bio version of naphtha, if you will, a mixture of aromatics and distillates. And then from the aromatic portion, you take the paraxylene out and then go on from there on out. On the other hand, somebody like an Avantium has an altogether different route. You know, this is their YXY or YXY technology, where they do a catalytic conversion of sugars to get to FDCA, then to ester, and then to PEF, an alternative to PET. In the Avantium example, because it's a furanics-based platform that has toxicity concerns associated with it, so even though it's a faster, maybe a more elegant process, it comes with regulatory risks. What you'll see as you look at this picture is, you know, Coca-Cola wasn't being a profligate spender when it decided to pick three partners. It picked three partners because there were inherent advantages and disadvantages to each of these processes and routes. More importantly, at this stage, it is too early to tell which of these guys is going to win out. So the only way you can access this market, if you were going to act as a true alpha, is to hedge your bets. And that's what Coca-Cola has done. In hedging its bets, what Coca-Cola has also done is improve the overall ecosystem's probability of success. They took the most problematic part of the ecosystem and decided to hedge their risks and improve the probability of that element by working with three altogether different partners. What this tells you is that there is an inherent difference between the way all of us think about innovation ecosystems, you know, what I'm calling here as the normal ecosystem, and an alpha-driven ecosystem. In a normal ecosystem, people tend to view this as more of an organic or natural agglomeration of players, right? You all just mutually understand that some things need to happen together and you come together and make that happen. Whereas an alpha-driven ecosystem is one that's very, very deliberate. There is an entity in there, the alpha, that is saying, here are the companies that need to be a part of this ecosystem. Here is what I think they need to do. So let's all come together and make that happen. In a normal ecosystem, there's a lot of emphasis put on everybody getting along together. We all want to sit by the campsite and sing kumbaya. Whereas in an alpha-driven ecosystem, you need to make some hard choices. You need to be able to make some pretty stark decisions about which technologies you prioritize and deprioritize, which partners you keep and cut in order for the greater good of the ecosystem. More importantly, an alpha-driven ecosystem is a goal-oriented machine. In the case of Coca-Cola, for example, the goal very much is 100% bio-based content. It's not to further Gevo's technology. It's not to start from sugars and do a thermochemical route. It is, let's get increased bio-based content in our bottles. How we do that? Well, we'll find the best partners that give the overall ecosystem the greatest chance of success. And that's the inherent difference in the way that we look at this. So let's try and see where this alpha-driven, beta-navigated approach of looking at partnerships and ecosystems take us. What we've done here is picked from our very many areas of coverage three particular areas that could greatly benefit from this sort of a framework thinking. Now, you can apply the same way of thinking to very many different things that all of you are working on as well. So I'll invite a discussion on that in the Q&A session and later. We also picked areas which are pretty large market opportunities and have an opportunity to make a pretty dramatic impact on the world we live in, right? So an interesting aspect of these three areas also is that either an alpha has not emerged in these markets, or where a company that should act like an alpha has emerged, it's not really acting like an alpha right now. So I'll try and call those out. Let's start with the space of wearable sensors. Now, I'm sure you've seen all of these out there, but if you haven't, my colleague Raymond Kramer is the managing director of EMEA for Lux. He's actually wearing one right back there. So this tall Dutch man with the tiny black band, you'll see him walking around. Now, wearable sensors are actually a pretty interesting technology, right? So if you talk to my colleague Milos, who heads up our bioelectronics practice, he'll tell you that some of the greatest challenges in human health over the next few decades is going to be understanding that there are various technology pillars that underlie the health preservation cycle. He will also tell you that the greatest drive over the next few decades is going to be towards point-of-care technologies. Something like wearable tech speaks to both of those areas. It speaks to the various aspects of the health preservation cycle, plays a role into all of them, but it also is very much an intimate part of point-of-care technologies. Now, what I'd like to underline here for you is that this is not a niche offering. Wearable sensors are already a pretty large market. So if you look at some industry estimates, this is actually projected to be a $6 billion market by the year 2016. More importantly, it's growing at a pretty fast clip, 40% year over year. But if you look at how this market breaks out, a vast majority of it, 60%, is fitness trackers, you know, those things that Nike and Adidas sell to you when you go into their store and are just about to check out. You'll also see that companies like Apple just filed patents that sort of indicate that they're going into the space. The healthcare aspects of wearable sensors are actually a fairly untapped opportunity. But if you'll also look back to the impact that you saw on the previous page, you'll see that if that opportunity is accessed, this could be an orders of magnitude larger market. So let's try and break that problem down. How do you get more wearable sensors into healthcare? Well, as you've probably gotten the drift now, we need to build out an ecosystem. So this ecosystem is likely going to involve the research community, but then you need a sensors company working with a device manufacturer. You need a data analytics company that is able to take that data and drive it to something that allows you to extract some value from that data. You need to have a brand partner, the channel partners. You'll need your physicians and consumers involved in this picture as well. And you'll need the insurance provider to play a role. Let's look at what are some of the critical needs of such an ecosystem. Well, firstly, if you look at the healthcare applications of wearable tech, these devices today are somewhere upwards of $100 a piece. When you start trying to put in the analytics portion, they start going well above $200, $300 a piece. At that price point, you're going well beyond the ability of individual consumers to pay out of pocket. You really need an insurance company to come in there and help finance some of that system. What you'll also see is that there is another need. If the basic problem with wearable sensors is to take the data that they capture and extract some value out of that data, you need to be able to link that to the data repositories that already exist. And that's a role, again, that the insurance provider can play. So if you look at this ecosystem, what we would view as the alpha partner here is actually an insurance provider. It's not a technology developer at all. This is a company like in the United States, like one like Kaiser Permanente, for example. Now, what an insurance provider is also uniquely able to do is take some of the sensor data and integrate it with the health information systems, the decision support systems that they already have. What this choice of alpha also tells you is an indicator of how you can find out which company should be an alpha. An insurance provider is invested in the success of the overall problem, right? They're interested in improving the health outcomes. But they're not invested in any particular technology. They're not driven by a technology push approach, but they're driven very much by the results of this innovation ecosystem materializing. You see that similarly in the Coca-Cola example, where they're invested very much in the final outcome, not in the technology that you're pushing. And that is the perfect alpha within such an ecosystem. So, as we talk about these ecosystems, you look at the companies that are here today, you'll realize that there are certain markets in which you can be alphas, and then there are certain markets in which you have to take on the role of the second in command, the beta. Well, if you look at the alpha-driven ecosystem, there are certain implications for the beta companies. There are certain different strategic decisions that you need to take. Let's try and break those down. So what you have here is for three different types of players, we've tried to break out what you would need to do if you were just developing a standalone innovation versus if you were trying to develop something that goes into an alpha-driven ecosystem. Well, if you're a sensor developer, you probably had to pitch the sensitivity of your innovation to a device manufacturer if all you were doing was just selling a product. On the other hand, in an alpha-driven conversion ecosystem, you need to inform your development roadmap by looking at the insurability of that particular innovation. If a particular innovation is unlikely to be insurable, you probably don't want to develop it. If you're a data analytics company, you have to transition from a straightforward event mapping to one where you're designing the analytics to integrate better with the health information systems. If you're a brand or channel partner, you need to move from a B2C approach to one where you're not only selling to consumers, but also marketing to the insurance companies. There are very different strategic decisions that you need to make when you start viewing the world as one that is an alpha-driven ecosystem. Let's look at another example, the case of natural gas vehicles and specifically their penetration within OECD countries. Now, natural gas vehicles is already a pretty large market. There's about 15 million of these out there on the streets today. And my colleague Andrew Soar and the alternative fuels team can give you all the details you need about where these things are going. But if you try and understand where the share of the vehicles is growing, and compare it to where the total vehicles on the road are, you'll see a very, very different picture. Nearly 93% of the NGVs that are on the roads today actually go into non-OECD countries. BRIC countries and others, you know, countries like Iran, Pakistan. But what you've also noticed is that there is a shale gas boom happening in some parts of the world today, which are most likely going to lead some of these companies to lobby for NGV policies. So you're now faced with a universe where in the countries where there is a shale gas boom, there is very poor penetration of NGVs. So how do you get NGVs into this market? Well, you need a multi-party push. So you'll need your oil and gas majors, your fuel transport and refueling infrastructure. You'll need your NGV tech developers to start working on conversion kits. You'll need your OEMs to come up with CNG or LNG type vehicles. And you'll need your regulators and policy guys to come out and do their bit as well. But understand what some of the critical elements of getting NGVs into the market might be. Well, the biggest driver of NGV adoption is actually the price difference between oil and natural gas. The second biggest driver of NGV adoption is policies. The markets in which NGVs have penetrated today have been very much a policy-driven market. And then finally, there is a role that the OEMs and NGV tech developers play as well in providing the new cars or the retrofit kits that allow you to access some of these policies and incentives. Well, in such a market, it's very important to understand that who the alpha should be is very much market condition dependent. So in a market like Europe, the OEM would actually be the perfect alpha, right? So you see that in the example of Italy, where the way that the market has been driven is because Fiat had struck up a pretty close relationship with Eni and the Italian government and has dramatically driven the adoption of NGVs in that country. Italy is a shining light in NGV adoption in Europe, whereas you know, places like Germany, UK, and France have been very poor adopters. But then if you look at a country like the United States, maybe the oil and gas major needs to play the role of the alpha. You know, these are the guys who are the most invested in making sure that NGV adoption happens. They're the ones who are going to lobby the government to make sure the right policies are put into place. And then in altogether different countries, maybe parts of the developing world, you need your government or the policy folks to understand that, hey, NGVs is what we need to do, and so we are going to institute a set of policies that are going to make this happen. Case in point, Russia. Over the last few days, I'm not sure if you've seen this come up on the news wires, but Russia and its state-owned entity Gazprom actually announced that they were going to skip the entire hybrid EV boom and go directly to NGVs. Something like that can overnight dramatically alter the market space. So in areas like those, it's the regulator and the policy folks that can play the role of the alpha. But now, if you are a beta, the choices you need to make in terms of the strategic decisions can vary pretty dramatically based on who the alpha is. Let's take the case of a NGV technology developer and look at how they might behave differently in these various regions. In places where the OEM is going to act like the alpha, your only path to market is through the OEM. In a place like Europe, a Fiat is going to design the vehicles and maybe even the conversion kits that will allow folks to transition from their conventional vehicles to natural gas vehicles. If you are not working with the OEM, that you have no channel to market. So in such a region, if you were an NGV tech developer, you'd probably try to find the markets where there's a very strong OEM, oil and gas major, and government partnership, and focus your efforts there. On the other hand, if you are selling into the US market, where an oil and gas major is the alpha, you might have a shot at going it alone. You might say, hey, I'm going to make this conversion kit and I'm going to market it directly to the consumer. Well, in that case, maybe the strategic choices you make are to integrate very quickly with an oil and gas major to inform some of the lobbying efforts that they'll do. In an altogether different region, like maybe Russia now, you might want to modify your technology roadmap to sort of follow the incentives. These are very different choices that you're making depending on which market you're aspiring to play into. Finally, let's look at a third example, the case of building systems integration. Now, you know, John talked about it in the earlier discussion, so I won't belabor the point, but the idea here is, since buildings are the primary consumers of energy, and since a vast majority of the building energy consumption happens during use as opposed to during construction or procurement, that's the part of the problem you want to tackle. Then if you look at where this energy in use is going, lighting and HVAC actually make up two-thirds of that puzzle. Appliances and equipment make up the other one-third. Now, a lot of smart people have thought about this problem, and they've come to the conclusion, as have we, that the way to actually make this happen is by trying to find a way to integrate all of these disparate devices and equipment and make them work with each other, talk to each other, and function in a more efficient fashion. Well, let's look at what you would need to put together to make that happen. Right, so in the case of integrated smart buildings, not only do you need the hardware, the meters, the switches, the equipment, and the appliances, you need the control software that will allow you to make these things push out the data that they are working with, but then also actuate a behavior change into those equipment and appliances. You would need a service provider, a company like a Concert or an O-Power, that allows you to take all of this intelligence and then take it to the consumer as a solution. You'd have the systems integrator playing a different role, and then certainly there are utilities and governments that have to do their own thing. You also have to understand that in this market, the consumers have very misaligned incentives depending on whether you're the owner or the occupant of a building. So what you're seeing happening in this marketplace is that the controls companies are now increasingly working with appliance guys and meters and switches providers to get integrated. But on the other side, you have systems integrators trying to be the full solution provider. So these are the Siemens building technologies, the Honeywell building solutions of the world. You also have utilities like Aon, EDF, various governments trying to force fit some of these solutions into play. The UK government, for example, and the Green Deal program. And on the other side, you have architects, owners, as we discussed, who have very, very misaligned incentives trying to figure out, what's this deal about? You know, how I own some property. How do I get it to be more efficient? In such an ecosystem, the service providers, you know, as I mentioned, a company like O-Power, pretty small company, you know, it's a startup essentially, or a slightly bigger one like Concert, might be the true alpha. Well, if you're looking at that picture, some of you might say, hey, aren't some companies doing this already? Well, let's look at the case of the Green Sigma Coalition. Now, this is a coalition that IBM put together a few years ago, where IBM started acting like the alpha, brought together players, some pretty marquee names in terms of system integrators, building automation and controls companies, IT companies, and brought them together to talk about how they can start and address this problem. The basic underlying principle here was the problem of convergent innovation. What IBM claimed in the very first declaration of this coalition was, this is a problem that no one of us can solve alone. We need all of our companies to come together and do something. Now, if you look at this picture and compare it to what you saw on the previous page, you'll ask yourself a couple of questions right away. Hey, where are the distributed generation owners? Where is the consumer interface? This coalition has a bunch of gaps that still need to be plugged for it to have any chance of success, despite the fact that you have some very strong companies already involved and talking about this problem. So if you look at some of these emerging innovation ecosystems and you look at the gaps that are in there, that's where the opportunity for the beta comes. So if, let's say, you're the distributed generation owner and you look at such an emerging ecosystem, you say, you know, what I could do here is really be a power player. I could take some of the innovations that these folks in the coalition are developing, and I can provide you with a pilot test site. In doing that, you capture an increasingly large share of the overall value. If you're the consumer interface, let's say you're an entity with building owner, occupant, operator access or data, maybe you're a city or a municipality. If you identify the right ecosystem and that has the best fit with your regional considerations, you can support the application development here. Understand that when one partner is the alpha, everybody else does not become insignificant. This is genuinely a partnership, an ecosystem of players that are all contributing to the solution and extracting value from having solved that problem. But also understand that this is not a collegial partnership. This is an ecosystem that needs to be driven by the strong hand of an alpha who makes those hard choices that we talked about. So if you try and put all of this together, the point I'd try to leave you with is that in the world of convergent ecosystems, it is no longer enough to manage your own innovation. You need to manage your innovation ecosystem. What convergent innovations also require is an alpha partner that modulates and drives such an ecosystem. To identify who an alpha is in an ecosystem, just look at the one who is furthest removed from a technology push and yet is maximally invested in the outcome. Look for a company that sets the vision and executes on it, makes the hard choices about technology and partners. In such an ecosystem, also understand that a beta might need to alter the strategic decisions it makes in order to be a viable participant. Now, some of us might look at this picture and say, yeah, you know, I don't know if I want to be a beta. This looks like a lot of work. And I do put in all that work and all I get is being called a beta. Well, understand that firstly, it is so much better to be a beta in an alpha-driven ecosystem than not be in such an ecosystem at all. But also understand that in the space of convergent innovations, if you try to go it alone, you are guaranteeing failure for yourself. Thank you, and I'm happy to take any questions.